it is the love of God for man and man for God. So agape is a giving type of love. It is a giving type of love with its fundamental, with its foundations in caring for one another. People who pursue this type of love do not expect anything in return. They care for their partner's well-being, not expecting any tokens of gratitude. We often assume that there is agape love in the body of Christ. But I tell you, there is no agape love. And when we get to the storge love, the family love, you begin to see why there isn't agape love. The God unconditional love. Is that what we see in the ecclesia? Do we see leadership loving everybody equally? Or do we see leadership loving the rich, the famous? Do we see leadership loving the lowest as the highest? Unconditional love. And this is the highest form of love. The depth to which a man knows God is the depth to which a man can display agape love. Because it is the God love. It is the God-given love. It's been found that there is a correlation between agape and mutual understanding in relationship. So when the agape love is deep, there's mutual understanding in that relationship. It can be a husband-wife relationship. When agape love is deep in each one of them, the mutual understanding is also deep. When agape love is deep, forgiveness is deep. And there is a modest number of arguments. You will not find arguments. And you will not find misunderstanding because of agape love. We sing it in the body of Christ. I can see in you the glory of the Lord. I love you with, is that true? Do we love with the agape love? With the love of the Lord, do we really love? That is why some say it is not human. Agape is given by God alone because he himself is agape. If agape love was in the body of Christ, we would not have the kind of divisions that we have. If agape love was between husband and wife, we would not have divorce anymore. The highest kind of love. That's why Romans 8:35 says, who can separate us from this love of Christ? Who can separate us? So what kind, if we are talking about agape love, if it's operating in the body, will there be divorce? But you and I bear witness that the rate of divorce is increasing in the ecclesia. Because if you cannot love the one that you see, the one who is with you, how can you say you love the God that you cannot see? It's impossible. It's impossible. What kind of premarital counseling do we have? Because that is where the problem begins. I've heard of all kinds of theories and all kinds of practices going on in the church. 6 months, premarital counsel. How can you correct a man who is set in his own ways? The man is set in his own ways. How do you correct him? How do you correct a woman set in her own ways? We are joking. I don't think we mean for real. All right. How many years, if you have a diploma, how many years of schooling did it take you to get a diploma? Look at from class one, look at junior high, look at senior high, look at tertiary. How many years? Maybe 10, I don't know. If you calculate, you know. If it's a degree, how many years? But if we can spend so much time, so someone goes to train even as an engineer, at the end of the program, the person says, I don't want to practice engineering anymore. I want to sing. Do you see that? 10, 12 years of learning engineering is thrown out to the winds. And you talk of 6 months of counseling. Are we serious? If even for engineering, that people can go into the profession and throw it away, we are talking of perhaps 10 to 12 years, at least, even at the university, you'll be talking of about 4 years. It can be thrown away. How much more marriage that is for a lifetime? Do you see where the mindset of the ecclesia is wrong? I recommend marriage counseling should start from college Sunday school class 5, class 6. It's a question of writing out the appropriate curriculum at every stage. Because that is when we can teach them, this is how a boy should relate to a girl. This is how to be polite to a lady. This is anger. You don't exhibit anger. This is how you help. By 10, 11, this is how you go to the kitchen and help. There's nothing like a man's duty, a woman's duty. Then we are training them for life. You talk of 6 months. I pray that God will open our eyes, that will begin to reverse the order. He says, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another, as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. It's a new commandment. If you cannot love the person next to you, the one you see, how can you say you love somebody in the ecclesia? How can you say you love God? Ludus, playful, flirtatious love. I like the word ludus. It's like ludu. You know, ludu is casting of the die, chancing. And that's what ludus is about. Playful, flirtatious love. It's a game of play. Partners are not treated seriously. And the relationship itself is perceived as a form of entertainment. And studies have shown that people who prefer the ludo style strive to get the upper hand in the relationship, being careful not to become the partner who loves more. So people do not release themselves. People do not demonstrate their affection. It's a game. It's a game. I also want to say to you is that the agenda of Satan for the end time is to drive people. Somebody's mic is giving us feedback. Thank you. So the end time agenda of Satan is to drive people into the ludus relationship. Don't you see there's playful relationship? Don't you see there's flirtation? Don't you see there is living together? If after 3 days I'm not satisfied with you, you pack off, I go. Someone says it should even be a contract, renewable every 3 years. Ludus, that is the work of Satan now. Then we have pragma love. It is committed, long-lasting love. People are running away from commitment. People are running away from long-lasting love. Pragma is a type of, it's a practical love based on common sense and sensibility. When people are in a relationship and they want to begin building a home, they need to look at pragma love. Be very pragmatic. Be real. Hey, when love enters through the door, be careful. Otherwise, your emotions will fly out through the window. And before long, you don't even know who you are. And instead of lifting holy hands unto the Lord, you would have lifted unholy legs. So a person initiates the relationship by preparing a list of pros and cons. There are things that have to be discussed. Many people enter relationships they do not discuss. For a long-lasting relationship, discussion must go on. There is a generation now that is not interested in the natural birth. Ah, no, the birth canal, you know, is going to be enlarged, is going to open up. No, it's going to be loose. They are not interested. And therefore, they are opting for cesarean. These are things that must be discussed. There is a generation now that, you know, they do not want to give the baby's breast milk because they say the breast will suck and all that. So they'll give them formulated milk. All these things will have to be discussed. Let's not joke that we are Christians and therefore these things should not be discussed. These are the very things that break marriage. It is the small foxes that spoil the vine. A close relationship is perceived as tantamount to being in charge of a company. And you are in charge of the company, the home company. Company, we need to understand that it is a group of people with a common agenda, a common purpose. That's a company. And you are in charge of that company. So pragma is connected with choosing one's partner using just common sense and trusting the relationship or investment will pay off. We are trusting that we'll go the full haul of marriage. And sometimes it's sad. Charismatics will say, well, wedding vows, we don't want to say in sickness and in health. Whether you say it or you don't say it, is there anyone who has never gotten sick? So whether you say it or you don't say it, sickness is not afraid of you. Whether you say in sickness or in health, sickness is not afraid. Some don't want to say in richer, for poorer, whether you say it or not. If God does not intervene and poverty will come, poverty will come. So it's not a question of what we say. It is a question of what we want to do in the relationship. If we understand it is not a company that we are cutting an agreement, it is a covenant. Pragma, very pragmatic. And a lot of time people enter without the pragma love. All right. I just want to leave it here. We'll take on this another time. When it comes to counseling, and people are looking at their partners, there are questions you need to ask. Jesus grew in wisdom, in knowledge, stature, favor with man and favor of God. Four dimensions. Are you on the same level on the four dimensions with your spouse or your spouse to be or your wife or husband to be? We are talking about love. Same dimension. Wisdom, knowledge, stature. Financial stature, social stature, educational stature, favor with man and favor, that's social status. Another day, God willing. So when the honeymoon is over, there is a nice mix of storge love and philia that continues. The eros is over, and you have a mix of storge and philia. And when one begins to build a family, the storge will go far and bind the family. But if you last long, eventually you have the pragma because it is an enduring love. If the marriage is going to last long, you have the mix of the storge and the philia and a mix of the pragma because it is pragmatic. It goes long, it's a long-lasting love. Enduring love. Pragma is where we get the word pragmatic. A practical kind of love. It stands the test of time. Pragma is like fine wine that matures with time and becomes more special. Philoftia, self-love. And I wouldn't go too much into this. Philoftia, from the etymology, ancient Greek, talks about self-love. This is different from narcissism. It's different from narcissism. Narcissism is just about you love, you are obsessed with yourself, obsessed with your image, obsessed with your personality, obsessed with your clothing, obsessed with who you are. It's an obsession. So it's different from narcissism. But when we talk about philoptia, it's self-love, to love yourself. Love yourself the way God has made you. If we love ourselves the way God has, we'll not have all these things, silicone, whatever, breast enhancement, and all these things taking place because you love yourself. Tanning of the body, bleaching of the body, you love yourself. So that is philotia. So philotia is a concept that has been used in ancient Greece. It means self-love, self-interest, taking interest in yourself. Because there is a belief that it was used to describe an individual's life for themselves and how they can take care of themselves, you taking care of yourself. If you don't take care of yourself, if you don't love yourself, how do you love another person? So the original meaning was that it was used to mean being interested in one's own welfare, to be interested in one's own welfare, to take care of yourself first. Be loved here. Take care of yourself first. Appreciate who you are. Appreciate what God has made you to be. Our God is a wonderful God. And life is a gift. That is why no two human beings are ever the same. God hasn't got a photocopier in heaven. So every one of us is the original. Every one of us is an individual, from the Greek word individus. Individus in, individus divide. So in means not, individus divided. So you are not divided. You are whole in your thinking. You are whole in your mindset. Because we have been made whole in Christ. We are individuals. There are life love styles. There are love styles. And recent studies on styles of love indicate discrepancies between genders. Men perceive love as eros and ludus more frequently than women. Of course, we don't expect this in the ecclesia. But I tell you, before you talk of a man of God, you are talking of a man first, before you talk of God. So we have people who are playboys in the ecclesia and playgirls in the ecclesia. We have people like that. I remember two sisters we met years ago. They were playgirls in the ecclesia. They wake up a man to the point where the man has given his whole heart and soul to them, and then they break the person's heart. They had to go through deliverance to be set free. And while women perceive love as a mania, I mean, they become maniacs. They give themselves over to love, and they are more pragmatic with love. Then we come to the storge love. This is the family love. And this is the major theme for our study this evening. But I needed to lay the foundation for us to know where we have come from, the various types of love, and those that we need to strengthen and to understand and to be operative in, and those that we need to run away from. Ludus, we need to run away from ludus love. So storge love. Storge love, from the ancient word, love, affection. The one I like most is familial love. That is family love. It is family love. You love your family. You love the members of your family. So it refers to the natural or instinctual affection. You have affection for the people in your family. Parents towards offsprings and children towards parents. Family love. Family love. Family love. I will touch on that at the end, because this is where the ecclesia has missed it. If you look in the book of Acts, where they were one, because I started oneness, that they may be one. When they are one, there is love, right? If you look at the book of Acts, you look at the day of Pentecost, 3,000 came, right? By Acts 5, you are talking about another 5,000 were added, right? By the time you get to Acts 6 and Acts 7, people started complaining in the ecclesia. Acts 5, that's where you now get Ananias and Sapphira coming in and showing a fake love, selling their things. Because Barnabas sold these things and everybody hailed Barnabas, they now went and sold their things and hey, they now decided to deceive the church. And when the church started becoming bigger and bigger, they lost the oneness, that oneness that they had from the beginning, of which they were in the upper room together praying. The ecclesia lost it and God had to break them up with persecution so that they get back. So if you look at the letters of Paul, as he gets to the end, he talks about the home churches, not until these big denominations and big numbers and people priding in that, and they cannot love. That is why the ecclesia cannot love. It's so big. Because the foundation, like Paul writing to Timothy, he said, let the house of God, let this ecclesia become the foundation and pillar of truth. That is a home church. The basic unit of the body of Christ. If there is love in a family, there'll be love in the home church. There'll be love in the general ecclesia. Family is where life begins and love never ends. I believe we've heard that saying before, there is no place like home. True, especially when you come from a long journey and you come back home and you lie on your bed, you say there is no place like home. It doesn't matter if you were in a 5-star hotel. Once you get home, you get onto your bed, it's a different feel. No place like home. There is family love. So Sturgeon was feeling a deep bond with one's partner. What is paramount importance? There's a close relationship. There's a friendly relationship. If your spouse cannot be your friend, I don't know who can be your friend. Then there is something wrong. That is why we have to be very pragmatic. There must be pragma love. Very pragmatic. This person that A is going to marry, are they even friends at all? If they are not friends, forget. If the partner has friends that he loves outside the home, there's a problem. There's a potential pitfall. There's a potential danger. Sturdy love will fail. If the person does not find the partner at home, a friend, the children as friends. Jesus, at the end of the tutelage of his disciples, I no longer call you disciples, I call you friends. When we have brought them up in storage love, and our children have grown from babies to young adults, they are no longer the babies we knew of. They are no longer the teenagers, they are now friends. Storage love. There's friendship relationship. It's mutual trust and there is caring. Partners in these type of relationships trust that they will spend the rest of their lives together. That is why when one is leaving the home, if there's sturdy love and your son is going to get married, you feel it. You can't hide it. You can't hide it. If there is sturdy love, your daughter is going to get married, you will feel it. You will feel it. And that's why you find some parents crying. And sometimes those living home also cry because there is love there. Sturdy love. They are moving to a new terrain. Will they still have more based on the foundation they've received at home? Sturdy love. This is what God expects of the ecclesia. Family love. That they'll be one as I am in you, unquote, Jesus. And you are in me, unquote, Jesus. storge love. Because when there's oneness, they can pray together. When there's oneness, there is unity. Psalm 133, when they dwell together as one in unity. Hey, it's oil that runs from the head of the garment to the beard of Aaron, to the sole of his feet. Not this beard that these young men, and young men, yes, not women, young men. Every young man seems to have beards. But is there oil in it? If a father, you have father, you have beard. Is there Aaronic oil in that beard that is running down to the hem of your garments and leaving footprints in your house? Because he says that there is love and unity. He says that is the oil. There's the smoothness of the family. There isn't friction. There isn't fighting. Are you with me? Storge love. Family love. And then Psalm 13 says, therein God commands a blessing. Do you see that? Do we see what storge love can do? It begins from our homes. It begins from the family. Partners and those types of relationships, or partners in those types of relationships, trust that they will spend the rest of their lives together. Storge love. It's a natural love. It's the family love. It binds families together. It binds races together. It binds nations together. It's a binding agent. Oh, is it that kind of situation where in the family, people are just waiting for this person to leave the family and they say, good riddance. Oh my God. Oh my God, good riddance. Or is it the type that some people have come to accept the local parlance in our language, in our local parlance, translated, that in every house, there is somebody called Mensa. It is a mindset that we need to throw away. Mensa is the black sheep in the family. And even the ecclesia and so-called Christian home seem to have accepted it, that in every home, there is a Mensa. I refuse. In my home, there is no Mensa. There is no black sheep in my home. Because there must be the bonding agent of love. It must bind. It is inevitable. It is automatic. There is affection. There is affection. We are together, binding together through thick and thin. May I tell you something? COVID-19 exposed storge love. The records are there. There was abuse in the homes. Some spouses that have never lived long together and in closeness because they were busy with work. This person goes, she comes, that person goes. They don't have time for each other. When there was a lockdown and they were forced to stay in the same home to face each other 24/7, some realized they were not compatible. What a pity. What a shame. Unfortunately, we do not have too many examples of this kind of love in the scriptures. Let me take the case of Abraham and the case of Jacob. No, let's take it from Isaac. Look at Isaac. What was happening in the family? Father loved Esau, the mother loved Jacob. What kind of love is this? Don't you see how the home was divided? Don't you see the wedge that the enemy plays there? So we don't have too many examples of this kind of love. The one that I think is very close is Martha and Mary. It was so, they loved Lazarus. There was storge love in that home. That was the family. If you check the scripture to find out a family that Jesus is this home. Storge love. So it is not Christ in the head of this family, the unseen guest at every, there's no storge love. How can Christ come in there? Father is fighting mother, mother is fighting father, Parents are fighting children. Children, now they are not talking to each other. They have separate rooms. You know, if anything, they are using WhatsApp text message in the hall. Where is the surgery now? Don't talk about agape, because all these were Christians. So they are all Christians. And on the first day of the week, otherwise known as Sunday, they all go to church. Where is the storge love? But Martha and Mary and Lazarus, there was so much of storge love. They loved, said that when Lazarus was sick, they went every length. Let's look for Jesus. Is there any place in the Bible that Jesus wept? Was it not because of this family that Jesus wept? Storge love. Storge love, family love. There's an interesting word that is close with that is philostorgos. Philostorgos. It's mutual love, that's a Greek word, mutual love of parents and children, wife and husband, loving affection, prone to love. And that comes, Romans 12, 10. Comes close to it. Let's read their translation, Philadelphia. Philadelphia seemed to shortchain the meaning, and to let it look like filial love. But filial love and storge love, they are quite different. Storge love is stronger. So if you look at, for example, the New King James, it's Philadelphia. It's Philadelphia. But we will look at some translations and we will see that it is philostorgios. Philostorgios. So if you look at Strong's dictionary, you look at 5361, it talks about fraternal affection, brotherly love, kindness, love of the brethren. So when we say brotherly love, let brotherly love, may the Lord help us. It's deeper than that. We'll get to know that. It's deeper than that. Which commands the believer be devoted to one another with brotherly love. What is the brotherly love? What is this brotherly love? Christians are members of God's family. Our lives are knit together by something stronger than physical ties. It is the bond of the Spirit. We are related by something more powerful than human blood. The blood of Jesus. Now, people keep on saying blood is thicker than water, meaning that family friends are thicker or family relatives are thicker, you know, than friends, because blood is thicker than water. So you have one blood, you have one family. True, true. But where the blood of Jesus is, it is stronger than the blood of any family, because the blood of Jesus speaks loudest. And he speaks better things on our behalf than the blood of bulls, the blood of goats, and the blood of Abel. God calls his children to love each other with the deep affection of storge love. Storge love. I may skip a few things, but in the papyrus, it is written, and it describes this as an affection. It is written, described. An affection. So we're talking of the records, ancient records that describe this thing. It's an affection. So it is affection. Yes, I've talked about it. And this could even extend to slaves and their owners, that this storge love could build so much. Have you had the experience of a house help coming to stay with you? And when the person has to leave, you begin to feel that there is some emptiness. That is if only we bind with them. That is if only we treat them as family. That is if only we consider that they belong to the body of Christ. So again, there is another word. I've said about it, 5384, philostorgos, and that is cherishing one's kindred, especially parents and children. They are fond of natural relatives. They are fond of natural relatives. So you can see the family. Do you see the joy? Is it real or is it being faked? You look at their face and you see that This, I think, is two generations. And you see that there is storge love. We come to our scripture, our anchor scripture, Romans 12:10. Be kindly affectioned, storge love, one to another with brotherly love, storge love. Is that what we see in the ecclesia? If we don't have storge love in our homes, we can never extend it to the ecclesia. Let alone the agape love, the God kind of love. So be kindly affectioned. The Bible enjoins us to be kindly affectioned. And this is the one that I want to talk about. It's mutual love of parents and children and wives. I'm emphasizing and I'm overemphasizing. Chiefly of reciprocal tenderness of parents and children. This is where the bonding begins. Storge love. And I'll take you back. That what we are saying is that even when the partner is pregnant, you begin to pray and you begin to exercise storge love and say, look, you coming to join us in this family, you place your hands on the tummy and you say, we love you, we welcome you, we are expecting you, we know you are going to be great. Oh, we are excited about your coming. Let me tell you something. You know that when husbands and wives quarrel, and there is a baby in the womb, the baby hears, and the baby begins to reject. And sometimes you see movements in the tummy. Oh, do I have a witness from somebody on the platform who's gone through this? I certainly do. I'm going deep now into the Orthodox Jewish Bible. And it goes, verse 10, show mispocha. That's the word that is used, mispocha. And that word is what? Affection to one another in ahava shal akal. Brotherly love. Be first in esteeming one another, in showing mutual respect. So mispocha. It is an entire family network comprised of relatives by blood. Do you see that? That is a love that comes with blood. That there is the binding of the blood and there is the binding by marriage. So when there's true marriage, you don't have outlaws coming to be in-laws. Because when they come, the storge love will be so stronger that they have to comply with. Love conquers all, isn't it? Love conquers all. So where there is the mispocha, it means that there is the blood. We agree we are being bound together by blood. First, the blood of Jesus. Second, family blood. And the blood of Jesus will speak better things on our behalf than the blood of bulls and the blood of goats and the blood of Abel. The book of James, I think I missed the particular verse and the particular chapter. But he says that if anyone fails to provide for his relatives, and especially for those of his own family, he has disowned his faith by failing to accompany it with fruits. And he's worse than an unbeliever. So when we say, I love you, the love of the Lord, and you fail, your own family, you fail to accompany it with fruits. You say you love your family, you love your spouse, you love your children, and you fail to accompany with fruits. This is what James is saying. You have disowned your faith. And you are worse an unbeliever who performs his obligation in these matters. Do you see that? That's why he said, if they will love them, if they will love one another, the world will know that indeed you have sent me. Ah, help us, Lord. The world is not seeing it because they cannot even see storge love in our homes. Some people may never enter your congregation, fellowship, ecclesia, church, but they'll enter your home. And when they see the storge love, they'll marvel. The peace in the home the love in the home demonstrates that Christ is indeed the head of this home. So we are looking at kingdom parents. And I've talked about poor examples in the Bible. For Jacob, I don't want to mention him. Jacob's family, oh my God, Uncle Jacob. Uncle Jacob married two sisters. So the children of Uncle Jacob, they know that their father married their mother and their auntie. Do you see that? Wow. And not only did he marry their mother and auntie, but he also even married their maid servants, Uncle Jacob. And in that family, there was so much division. They even hated, Joseph. They decided to sell him. What a family. What a family. Jacob's family. No wonder God had to encounter this man and say, look, we need to reconfigure you. We need to rechange you. We need to remold you. Get you back to the factory set. Your original name is Israel. For you have prevailed with God and prevailed with man. Not this Jacob, a trickster, a cheater. No, we need to configure you back to the original. So when we talk about the kingdom parents, I will look at the gold standard from Luke 15, 11 to 32. That's the gold standard. It is about the kingdom. The kingdom. It is about love. It is about agape and storge love. It's about caring. It's about providing. It's about a closely knit family. It's about a touch of love. It's about a tri-generational training. We'll talk about that. We'll talk about that. There's the uniqueness of each child. That means that parents must have an unusual love for each child. Because each child is unique. And we must have an unusual love. The Bible says it in Ephesians 4:2. Forbearing love. We need forbearing love. What is forbearing love? It is to bear up against all odds. It is to control one's feeling. The way I feel, it's not about me, me, me. At the end of the day, it's about the family. At the end of all this, how will the family? At the end of this storm, how will the family stand? Or is it about me winning the argument? Is it about me showing that I'm in charge? Will it make the family stand together as a unit? So it is forbearing love means I need to abstain from me. I need to refrain from me. I need to tolerate others. I need to endure. Let's look at it. The probability of the DNA of man, the probability that this DNA of man that God has made, if it's not God and it's man-made, when we talk about genes and genetic permutation and how accurately they do things, you look at a child that is born and you look at the parents and say, that one has picked the father's image, that has picked the mother's image. If anybody says a game of chance, it will mean it will be 10 to the power 40,000 for it to be a game of chance. It is the finger work of God. That is why the psalmist said, for you form me, or you form my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Do you see that? Every child is fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and my soul knows very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret. God weaving every one of these children in secret. My, oh my, we can't fathom this. It is a handiwork of God, skillfully wrought in the lowest part of the earth, the womb, the lowest part of the belly of the woman. So the father's capacity to tolerate the demand. If we look at the story that we're talking about in Luke, that when the young child came and said, I need my inheritance, the father had to stomach the issue. Because we are fearfully and wonderfully made, we must be careful what we ask of God. Israel asked for a king, and God gave them a king instead of he, God, leading them. So the first thing that we need to have, I have said it, one, that we need to have a positive, first of all, I talked about unconditional love. I talked about this persevering love. And that was what the father had. That was what the father had. Let me just go back a little again for us to see this forbearing love. If you look at Luke 15, 1 to 32, we all know it so well, so I don't want to go into it. It's the story of the prodigal son. When the child left, the child asked for his inheritance. The father gave the inheritance with love. Jesus. You go for your pension, and your son says, your daughter says, give me my portion of your pension. And you give it with love. That's what the father did. That's what the father did. An unusual love. Bending backwards. Because he loved the child. That is stodgy love. That is stodgy love. Forbearing love. To forbear. They may ask for things that we do not agree. But because of prayer. Because we know where God is sending them. Because they were conceived by the grace and mercies of God. Because there are prophetic words that will guide them in life. So we know that this prodigal son will come back. The father knew the prodigal son would come back. Just like Abraham going to sacrifice Isaac. He told the servants that were with him, stay here. We will go further. And he continues to say, and come back, implying we will come back. And if you go to Hebrews 11, he says that because Abraham knew that even if he would kill Isaac, God was able to raise Isaac up. What a God we serve. What a God we serve. For very long. Knowing that even if they are asking for the most unreasonable thing, they will come back to us. Storge love. Storge love. Storge love. So forbearing love, number one. Number two, we need a positive mindset in the face of all odds. The father had a positive mindset concerning his son. He continued to keep the altar of prayer, praying for the son. He was watching and praying. And perhaps, let me put it in contemporary times. The father would go out into the street. He would look and see, is my son coming home? If the son left the city and went to a bus terminal, from time to time, he would go to the bus terminal. Is he going to come home? Is there any news coming from the far away country concerning my son? Because he had a positive mindset. This one was conceived, given to us, a family, as a gift. Satan cannot take it. Even so, Lord, we pray that where families have not exercised the storge love and children have left home and they left with disagreement, and sometimes it's the case of a spouse leaving because of disagreement, that has not been your original pattern, because we know that the devil today is out there to attack nothing but the ecclesia. The devil wants to attack the ecclesia left, right, and center. And therefore, for such people, we pray. We know that God gives, and whatsoever God gives is forever. Satan is the one who comes to steal and to kill her and to destroy her. And therefore, any family where the storge love is gone, where a family member has been stolen by the enemy, either into drug addiction, either into some form of addiction, alcohol, into prostitution, into anything, we will not let the altar run dry. We will continue to pour the oil of prayer like the prodigal son's father. We are positive and we have a positive mindset that this my son, this my daughter will come back home. He was waiting for the return. Parents must therefore have 110% positive mindset about the family member. Each one of us must have 110% positive mindset. I believe in you, my son. It doesn't matter what your grades say. I believe in you. I have confidence in your future. You'll be great. You'll be mighty. You'll be strong. Especially at this time in my country when the West Africa senior examination results have been released. Look, let the family love prevail. This is not a time for blaming. It's not a time. Storge love. Love conquers all. This is a time that we need to encourage them. Where they did not do well, I believe in you. I trust you. I know you will make it. Look, go to the story of, let's say, Judges 19 and Judges 20. Read Judges 19 and Judges 20. See how many times the whole of Israel went before God, before they were able to conquer, you know, Benjamin, the tribe of Benjamin. See how many times they went before God. It was on the third count where they went before. Even by the second count, God said, you go, and they were defeated. It was by the third count, by that third count, they were now fasting before the Lord. They were praying before the Lord. And God said, you go and I'll give you the victory. So we are not giving up. We are not going to give up on them because of the storge love. We are bringing all of them back home. Parents must therefore have 110%, you know, positive mindset concerning the gift. Let me ask you a question. If the most important president in this world gives you a gift, oh, wailing women, I know how much you'll be wailing for the nations. For each one of you, I'm giving you a badge of honor. So the president pins a badge of honor for each one of you. How will you treat that? How will you treat that badge of honor? Will you throw it away? You will leave it there to tell generations unborn. How much more a gift? Isaiah 65:1-3. I'm sought of them that asked not of me. I am found of them that sought me not. I said, behold me. Behold me. Unto a nation that was not called by my name. I have spread out my hands all day long unto a rebellious people. Have you seen that? God says, I have stretched out my hands all day long. That is what we ought to do. If any family member has left and left under unfavorable circumstances, under confusion, under a fighter, we say that our arms are still straight. That is what the prodigal father did. His arms were straight. Kept on saying, come home, come home, come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home
endlessly,
tenderly.
Jesus calling,
calling,
and
come home.
Jesus.
Let me tell you something about the composer of this song. Because Jesus himself said, all those the Father gave me will come to me. And whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. All that the Father gave me, I have kept them. Every family member that God has given to us has been given to us. Will Thompson composed this song. I'll tell you about Will Thompson, and I'll make it very short. Let's leave a lot of the reading, but I'll tell you. This man, well-educated, a musician, he had a problem. The problem was that he composed songs and nobody wanted to buy his songs. All the publishers rejected his songs. So Will Thompson decided that, look, let me form my own publishing company and publish my own songs. Is that not a sensible thing to do? So he formed his own company and published his own song. And the first song that he wrote is Earnestly, Tenderly, Jesus is Calling. That song was so powerful, it has been used for altar call. It has even been used at burial service. And Moody, most of us know Moody. When Moody was on his deathbed, now Will Thompson went in there to visit him. The physician would not allow Will Thompson to go. But when Moody heard the voice of Will Thompson, he told the physician, allow him to come. And Will Thompson got there. You know what Moody told him? Will, I would rather have written softly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, than anything I've been able to do in my whole life. Of course, when a man is transiting to meet his maker, this is the song he will hear the heavens sing. The angels will sing this song. Come home, come home. The third thing, so I've talked about forbearing love, I've talked about a positive mindset, and I said, we must forgive and forget. The very minute the son left home, the father had forgiven and forgotten. Look, if you read the story, while the son was busy confessing, oh, father, you know, forgive me, I have done this, you know, against you. The man said, he was not even thinking about it. He was not even concerned about it. And he was only thinking of garments that could come so that he will be able to place a royal robe on his son. That is all that he was thinking of, that his feet should be washed. He had dealt with the emotional challenge of the child. Coming home, how do you think his son was feeling? His feet were heavy. Were his feet not heavy? You squandered your father's inheritance and you are now coming home. What are you going to say to your father? If it was the typical African tradition, you will arrive and they'll tell you to stand outside the gate. Who are you? What is your name? Who do you want? What can we do for you? Okay, wait at the gate. Now the father goes to call the mother. Hey, you know, mommy, hey, we have a stranger here. We have a stranger. Hey, there's somebody here. Call this, who went to the faraway country. Now he says he's coming home. And you come home and they'll ask you to kneel down and to, no. The father knew that there was an emotional challenge. And his role was to soften that emotional challenge. And therefore, he had forgiven and he had forgotten. Our God himself says that as far as the east is from the west, that is how far he has removed our transgressions from us. This is the agape love we are talking of. Not the kind of thing that we do that we mark things on the wall. This is what my son are. And you keep on reminding, even when you accept him and he comes back home every day, you remind him, that is not a sturgy love. That's not something that you did. You know, you did this thing at this time, you did that at this time. Hey, sturgy love is not like that. He had forgiven and he had forgotten. As far as the east is from the west, that is how far he has removed our transgressions. The fourth thing is that, remember, each one of them is a champion. They were born champions. Oh, can I get an amen from somebody? They were born champions. Do you know the number of male seeds that they needed to compete against? They had to run against all the male seeds in order to be victorious, in order to fertilize the eggs. They are champions. The rest were flushed out. So they were born champions. And we must make them the champions that they are. I pray that there will be no contention against their lives. It will not be like the time of Isaac. He discovers a well and there's strife in Isaac. Isaac is bound from their lives. Then it's 26. He moves on. He gets another well. And then there's envy. Envy is moved away from their life. They are champions because he will sing a song of deliverance around them. We must make them the champions they are. Make your spouse a champion. Don't be you alone. Don't let it be you alone developing yourself. You alone, you are the educated person. You alone, you are going to school. You are acquiring degrees. No. Because of storge love. Storge love. I must bring my spouse to the level that I am, so that we can move together. Storge love. It's unfortunate. It's unfortunate. I've seen people who divorce their wives as soon as they enter a new profession. Some of them, I was in literary academy with them, as soon as they came out and they became commissioned officers, they no longer found their wives or their spouses to be worthy, and they left them. A calling, a physical calling of the earth. How much more a divine calling? Kingdom calling. May the Lord help us. Some are called to become lawyers. As soon as they are lawyers, they leave that struggling wife who struggled with them. Because now they must attend some functions and they need to go with a certain so-called class. Lift up your spouse. Bring the person to that. Because of this blood is the blood that binds us. If you have time, look at the story of Derek Anthony. Derek Anthony. Derek Anthony Raymond. Please Google and look at it. Because his father made him the champion. During his career, he held the British record for the 400-meter sprint and won gold medals in the 4x400 meters relay at the World Championship and European Championships. Now, listen. During the 1992 Olympic Games in Barcelona, Raymond tore his hamstring in the 400-meter semifinal, but continued the race limping with the assistance of his father. His father came out of the crowd. He came out of the spectators and he lifted the son. And the son was limping, like the Bible describes the man at the beautiful gate, walking and limping and praising God. And he managed to finish the line and cross the line. Of course, by Olympic Games standard, he was disqualified and listed as not finished because he was assisted. However, when he crossed the line, there was a standing ovation by the acts of the father. Even when, you know, the coaches tried to move the father away, he persisted and said, "He is my son. I know him better than you. He is my son." There was a standing ovation for Raymond. There was a standing. And today, if you visit this website, is it something I can log on? If you can see the video, let me know. If you cannot see the video, let me know. Do you see the video? Can I get a feedback?
No, we are not.
You can't see the video.
Not yet.
Do you see the video?
No, sir.
Can I get a feedback?
No, we are not seeing a video.
Do you see the video?
No, please. Sorry, it lost, bro. It looks like we have lost, bro.
You hear me, please?
Yes, we can hear you.
You hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
yes, sir.
We can hear you, sir.
All right, that's fine. Let me get back to screen sharing. All right, so the last point is that we need divine wisdom for conflict resolution in the family. We need divine wisdom for conflict resolution in the family. Divine wisdom for conflict resolution in the family. So the major variables found to be responsible for conflict resolution in the family, they will include personality, personality differences most of the time. The use of money, that's finance, some of the time. Intellectual differences, it may rarely occur. Conflicts may have been triggered by any one of these variables or a combination. Three things: personality differences, finance, educational or intellectual differences. But most of the time is personality differences. So we need wisdom for conflict resolutions. Jesus himself said, it is impossible, but that offenses will come. Offenses will surely come. But how we handle them, how we handle the conflict. So the first thing in handling the conflict, that which seeks to break the story, the first thing is that we want to perform it. It's not about who won, who lost. It's about preserving the family. The second thing is that we want to be on in handling the conflict. The third thing is that there is an ultimate thing, the family love, your anger. The man will turn his head to one corner of the middle. Hey, now the children are, no. You must choose an appropriate time to discuss the problem. It may require, let's have some peace. Let's cool it down. Sometimes you would say, all right, as head of the family, I'm wrong. I'm sorry, I am wrong. Please, storge love will require us to be able to say, I'm sorry, when we are sorry. If you are a spouse and you have never said, you find it difficult to say, I'm sorry, please, take 3 days, go out into a pray and say, I'm sorry several times and come back home and say, I am sorry. It doesn't matter. It can be, I'm sorry to the children. It doesn't matter. It can be, I'm but it must be, I'm sorry. Still forgive. So this is a challenge that I had. Things that I wish my parents would do more. And the children say, I wish my parents would have more time for us. I wish my parents would have more time for us. I wish I could be bold and speak freely to my parents. Have you seen where there's storge love? Fear is cast out. Bible says perfect love cast out all fear. I wish my mom was patient and understanding. When it comes to certain issues, there are certain things we'd rather easily, you know, be told to ask our dad and ask that our mom doesn't know. Have you seen that? I wish my dad could tell us he loved us. I wish my dad could provide more. I really wish he, she had time for us. I will end here. Someone said, I wanted him to be a friend. That is what our children are longing for. Jesus himself said, at the end of the training, when he was about to leave and the disciples had graduated, he said, I no longer call you servants. I call you friends. All right. There is light at the end of the tunnel. Shalom to you all.